These are the gunmen the world knows as the Janjaweed, accused of mass rape and murder in Darfur. Until now, their bases have never been seen by the outside world. We traveled hundreds of miles through hostile territory to meet them. The United Nations wants their senior commander investigated for war crimes.
This is Commander Mohammed Hamdan.
The Sudanese government claims it doesn't back the Janjaweed, but these fighters told me the government gave them their weapons. Many were made in China.
You can see here that the mortars actually have Chinese symbols on them. They're Chinese made.
We'd arrived as they considered a decision that could affect the whole Darfur conflict, whether to turn their guns on the government.
I said, "Will you fight them?" And he said, "We will fight them till Judgment Day."
Darfur is a part of Sudan that its government doesn't want people to visit. We'd chartered a plane to get there.
We're just crossing the border into Darfur from the south of Sudan. The only access point that the Sudanese government in Khartoum doesn't have control over.
No one knows how many hundreds of thousands have died in Darfur during 5 years of war. Sudan's people are a mix of Arabs and Africans, but it's those of Arab descent who hold most power. The killing began when Darfur's Africans rebelled, demanding a greater say in government. Arab fighters, the Janjaweed, took up arms against the rebels and drove millions from their homes. I'd heard there was a chance some of the Janjaweed would meet us. Our pilots plan to land in a clearing in the scrub.
If I'm honest, I would have to admit that I'm really, really worried. We have absolutely no way of knowing whether this strip of land is usable for landing.
My contacts were local Arabs who'd agreed to take us to a key Janjaweed base. It meant a 300-mile drive across southern Darfur. Our guides carried weapons because of the war and because of bandits. We soon saw the first consequences of the conflict.
We're just coming up to the first displaced people's camp that we've encountered so far on our journey west. I think these are the images that people really associate with Darfur.
A tribal leader wanted to show me around the camp. It opened just 4 months ago.
This is the only water tank for this entire camp for 8,000 people. This camp is... They're telling us that this camp is actually full to capacity. So when they did the last count on the 24th of December, it was at 8,000, but they've had to keep taking people in, even though there's nowhere to put them. It's just incredible to me that 5 years on from the beginning of this conflict, there is still the capacity for new camps, that people are still being forced out of their homes.
This is Fatma. She just fled with her family from their home 40 miles away. She said one afternoon men rode into their village shooting. They killed 8 people, and those who could ran away.
What was your life like before the trouble started?
She says their life used to be so good. They lived in brick houses.
She said they had donkeys and livestock. And she said we had a means of living. And now we're here under borrowed matting, waiting for handouts.
This was the second time she'd been forced to flee her home.
She said that there are only so many times that you can gather up the hope to start again. And this time she said this is the last time. They want to die here, if they can't go home. Who do you think is responsible for this? She didn't want to say in the beginning, but in the end she said that it was Arabs, that they came together and rode into their town and stole their livestock and burnt the village.
These stories of Janjaweed attacks have been repeated for 5 years. The United Nations accuses the Sudanese government of being behind the Janjaweed and of helping organize the violence. The government denies this. One reason I wanted to meet the Janjaweed was to find out if the government was telling the truth.
We've been traveling all day and we're still not even at the halfway point where we're going to spend the night. And now we've got a flat tire. That's our armed guard. He'd initially started digging with it, with all the bullets in the cartridge in the gun. And then halfway through, it was pointed out to him that that perhaps wasn't such a good idea.
We were just outside of the Janjaweed commander's territory. The Janjaweed don't usually talk to journalists, but I'd heard this commander and his 20,000 men had fallen out with the Sudanese government and might be willing to talk. Over a satellite phone, they gave me a rendezvous point.
We're just about to meet our escort car, sent by the former Janjaweed commander. Alhamdulillah, assalamu alaykum, azayakum, inshallah, tayyibin. Alhamdulillah. Kwaysin, alhamdulillah, da'abnaakum ma'ana, matkoon istannatuna kateer. This is the commander who's been sent to meet us.
He told me that they'd fought against the rebels on the Sudanese government's behalf for 5 years, but received little in return. So their leader had decided to lift the lid on their relationship. Their territory covers most of southern Darfur. They had held it for the government, pushing back the rebels, but now they'd fallen out with the government. Already there had been clashes. They showed us the route to the garrison.
Our escort says that this route is safe and that we won't be meeting any trouble, and they should know, because if we'd been traveling this route a few months ago, they were the trouble.
We'd been driving for 2 days. They said the garrison was another 2 days north. Our escort was heavily armed for the journey.
The machine guns got amulets with verses from the Quran, blessed by a local sheikh, and all of them are wearing them. What do these protect you from? They stop bullets. Said even if a spear comes right in, it won't pierce you.
The Sudanese government has denied arming the Janjaweed, but these fighters said that wasn't true. They told me to look at where their weapons had come from.
You can see on this box, just across here, it says Yarmouk Industrial Complex, which is the main government industrial armament complex, which is under US economic sanctions for involvement in the manufacture and shipping of arms to Darfur.
One of the officers, Jefna Al-Bakhid, says he was recruited by the government.
So how are you recruited?
He says at the start of the conflict, government recruiters went around Arab neighborhoods, promising rewards for those who took up arms against the rebels. There was a rush to join. But he says these rewards, being looked after by the government and investment in Arab villages, never came. We were approaching a government stronghold. The men were worried government sympathizers might alert the army to our presence.
Our escort have asked that my director be brought into the back seat next to me, and they've tried as best as they can to conceal the fact that he's white by wrapping him in one of their scarves.
They stopped briefly to show us the aftermath of a recent clash with the Sudanese army.
This is 20 kilometers from Niala, from the government stronghold in South Darfur.
They told us the government sent in planes to bomb them in revenge for their defection.
He said his brother was killed here under the bombardment. He said that this is where someone else was killed. This is where the blood was.
We didn't stay long.
There's a Sudanese government helicopter that's been circling overhead. But once we're out of the circumference of Niala, then we're hoping it'll be okay.
Finally, they told us we were approaching the garrison.
The garrison is just there.
At first, all we could see were trees. Then we realized we were in a vast concealed camp.
This is not what I expected at all. There are people sleeping under trees. There are people cooking and out in the open. It's not a conventional military garrison.
They said 1,000 of their 20,000 men were based here.
We've been told that the reason they chose this garrison is that unusually for this part of Darfur, there's a lot of tree cover, so that when government aeroplanes fly overhead, the troops can move under the trees. Assalamu
alaikum. They were keen to show us their heavy weaponry.
So this is the remote, and then the numbers on the remote correspond with the numbers of the tubes for the mortar. You can see here that the mortars actually have Chinese symbols on them. They're Chinese made.
The Chinese government has been accused of flouting a UN arms embargo that bars the supply of weapons to groups involved in the Darfur conflict. China denies this.
More Chinese letters, another Chinese made. Dasini? Yeah, they say it's a Chinese gun. This is a Sudanese armed forces truck with